to moving towards an idea of, you know, kind of schizophrenic conversation, where he says a conversation is something that is you have moments of silence and lightning between these things. And maybe my translation is not very good there, but anyway, the idea that you can have a kind of non-communicative sort of coming together of voices. I think, you know, what to be expected here is not a dialogue, but this kind of transmission of shock. At least three of us. So I'll do a really quick introduction, because I know you now know who the three of us are, but Peter Stamer is going to do his presentation tomorrow, which is a film, or maybe like a cinematic idea, or Deleuze's we can actually come back to this idea of what it means to for art to think or to have an idea as material, cinematic. And Mark, whose drawings are all along the wall here on the right, actually has kind of already invested in this. Is problematic, which is, you know, how do you think a thousand photos and how do you rethink your images? So I think that's a conversation here to be had. I think I'm going to just function as a cutting point. I'm not going to really bring this conversation, because I think that's not the function of a... I don't want to be a mediator, I'd rather be some sort of conductress. And I think that we'll start probably with some questions that Eric already has to address to Anne.
Yes, I mean, we are all a bit slow. To answer the right question or possibly interesting and opening question at the right time. So, I mean, let's think.
Speak louder.
Sorry?
Speak louder.
Louder?
Yes.
Whoa, okay.
Maybe you have to
okay, sorry. I had a question that I wanted to address to Anne. Coming back to what she said at the very beginning of her talk, where she was extraordinarily critical about the very notion of history, and somehow expulsing the very notion of history out of her own, let's say, inquiry. Which for me was a bit paradoxical. I mean, immediately when she started to talk about the break produced by the digitalization.
Really, history in general.
The question for me is trying to articulate something which was for me a bit difficult too with Yann's presentation. So I just would like to be able perhaps to articulate the problem with regard to history, which is, yeah, I mean, it's a question of the digital. It's a question of the digital art. You concluded your presentation on digital capitalism. You explicitly said, and this is of course right, yeah, that what are we doing here? We are obviously producing some kind of operations, let's put it this way, from Deleuze and Guattari to address a time which is our time, and which is not their time. And I think that on this, we all deeply agree. Yeah? And this is perhaps one of our consensual critique about the kind of, let's say, academic Deleuze-Guattarism, yeah? Which is simply integrating Deleuze or Deleuze and Guattari, or even Guattari into the field, let's say, of history of contemporary philosophy. Okay. So I think that the this question of the history is quite important, including, and here I'm going to Yen's talk and presentation. It was quite clear for me that in your, from the shopping mall to the airport, somehow, let's call the thing in a very, very easy way, but which is our president. Yeah? I mean, the break is the neoliberal break. Yeah? That's the real question. Okay. Now, and this is something quite important, because I think where Deleuze and Guattari have been absolutely brilliant and are largely explaining why we can't and we still need to read them, including politically and with regard to our very, very political questions, is because at the very end of A Thousand Plateaus, they have been perhaps the first philosophers able to address the neoliberal question when it was not obvious at all. Let's say that neoliberalism for real, starts in the mid-70s, okay? And they have been really able to address this in an amazingly consistent and radical way. And I think that this largely explains some kind of switch from the anti-Oedipus to A Thousand Plateaus. Other French philosophers have been less successful addressing the neoliberal question. Let's think, I hope there is no very orthodox Foucauldian in the room, but let's think about the birth of biopolitics, where, I'm sorry, you can take it as ever you want, but Foucault is effectively accepting, developing, investing, reenacting something like a new liberalism. So, and it was to a period where it was a big playing with the new philosophers, etc. I mean, anyway, it was not so clear. So just to finish this improvised and very all too impressionist intervention, my question is really with regard to history. It means, don't we need properly the very notion of history to think what we are all very differently trying to do with Deleuze and Guattari, having to think and to problematize some breaks that effectively happened in our life and are really properly making the present in which we live?
So it's a misunderstanding, because the whole concept about art machine is completely historical, of course. What I meant to say in the beginning of my talk is it's an answer to as an answer to Camus' presentation, because I was afraid that you might think that I'm doing some parallelization, as if I would think that parallelization is solid frame that is incapable of improvement. But then I am among the people who always argue when Deleuze and Guattari are addressed. I think on Foucauldian critics, sometimes people would mean to say that there is no history by Deleuze or Guattari's thought. And I think it's completely wrong. Maybe even more for Guattari, who is really transforming history, and it's completely wrong for Deleuze also. And so history for me is a critical question. Now, the question is, what type of history? And you saw that I used examples of trying to figure out what would be the edges of these art machines that are characterized as being something that has been
dépassé.
Okay, thank you. And my two examples were digital art and Van Eyck. So this is a response. History is about a cutting edge, and so it's about thresholds. And so you need to put
these cutting edges, but you can put them where you want. And so it's not a question of will or of impulsivity, it's a question of problematizing. So did I. And I problematized this Western art machine with one hand in this one-eighth elevator, and on the other hand, something that would be interesting regarding digital art. So anyways, and I was about to talk about that anymore. Actually didn't, but I was. I had the previously. I wanted to talk about some art piece that she did in 2006 called Diaries.
Montagnac.
And this is really incredibly interesting.
Sorry, diary or diary?
Diary.
Journal.
Journal.
Right? She writes it in English, diary. It's a diary. It's not an intimate one, it's more like an extimate. Not intimate, but. And she did it at the time where it was the first possibility to record with the cell phone. And so it's like a little work that she was capable to do in the dans la cuisine de son emploi du temps. In the old
spare time.
Yeah, spare time. So in order to have a conceptualization of history, you need not a chronology and not a periodization, but you need a cutting edge. That is, you need to begin with periodization. So periodization is always about transforming both past and present. This would be my first answer. My second answer would be that I believe very strongly that we need to put historicity both in philosophy and, of course, in discourses about art. So we need to be capable to have a historicized version of formalism. Formalism, and this is very crucial for us, both in the dimension of art and in the dimension of philosophy. This is the way to quit, once and for all, the position of internalized notions. It is about ceasing to put eternity in our concept. But the contrary of eternity is not a certain type of succession. This is the main difficulty. So we have to come up with a concept of history that is not contingency versus eternity, which would be something that is completely out of fashion, though a large part of contemporary philosophy use this concept of contingency, but I believe it's completely outdated, because when you speak about contingency, you are opposing contingency and something that would be necessary. But the important thing for us is to think the necessity of change. And this necessity of change cannot be addressed in terms only of creation. Because creation is not the right answer to these questions, because creation can be confused with some kind of theological renewal, Bergsonian spiritualism, so I hate it. So we need to come up with a constructionist version of historicized formalism.
I wonder how that actually comes, how that both is tying into the temporarity of a new sort of temporarity of this incorporating historicity as it actually operates when you talk about in the analysis, because when I go back to the night and what you were saying, talking about this material conjunction, actual materialism is time, the wood that he sourced from such and such a place,
there were actual
conditions.
It was like a whole factory.
Okay.
You have the painters, but then at first you have the guy who is doing the woodcraft, which is a
there is a kind of empiricism there at work, you know, in how one's looking at, I'm wondering, I'm asking, circumstances of, you know, these material production, and you know, what are the factors, I mean, how do we risk that kind of return to a certain kind of contextualism where, you know, and coming back to the whole sort of social art history,
right.
Weak social art.
So another point, if you are asking my position, is that I believe, of course, in empiricism, but then the question is, what is empiricism? But of course, it doesn't mean it has to be empiricism. If I say it's not modernity, so it is related to
I just jump in on the periodization. Probably, I always think of myself as a Jamesonian before I think of myself as a Deleuzian. I came to Deleuze by Jameson. Because one of the things that, I mean, Jameson always says that started with sort of unconscious, always historicized, which is kind of a nice slogan. But if you look back at difference in repetition, Deleuze says something quite extraordinary. He says, we need both a science fiction and a detective story, you know, to talk about the present. And that's something that, that Jameson has latched onto. But I think he means something like this, that with a detective story, you always have a body and you wonder how it got there. And with a science fiction story, you look at the present from the perspective of the future and you ask yourself, well, you know, how do we get to be how we are? And I think in some ways those two lines of thinking converge. And I think that kind of goes, it sort of extends, to my way of thinking, extends through all their work. They're constantly asking us to periodize. But in that sense of always looking back and saying, well, how did we get to be where we are right now? What were the processes that took place? And I think that, you know, to pick up on Eric's point, the idea that Antipas is a kind of critique of neoliberalism as it was happening, I think is absolutely right. And one of the things that comes out of that is the notion of the axiomatic as a way of thinking about government or a way of thinking about governmentality in the absence of anything to believe in. And I would, I guess I would suggest that maybe that would be a different way of saying what I was saying before about art, that art must now take its chances in the realm of a mode of existence, a mode of subjectivity that cannot be grounded in anything that we can believe in. It must always take its chances against an axiomatic that is constantly shifting.
Yeah, so I mean, sorry, I really don't want to monopolize, just to come back to art, you know, as you did it quite nicely. I mean, at this point, I think the real question is to see if we think with and beyond Deleuze and Guattari, that we are still in this time opened in the 60s, which gives, let's say, a historical, ontological problematization of the very notion of art. And, okay, I mean, this brings some kind of heavy consequences. Okay. Or, if we think that precisely there has been a break, that perhaps one of the symptoms of the break would be the one the art world, the market are entering into this absolute commodification and archivization of perhaps, and after all, the art of the 60s. So, I mean, this is something quite interesting because obviously, and this is the interesting thing, I think, Deleuze and Guattari, let's be frank and let's be clear, okay? Now, problematized the contemporary art question as such. That is not their problem at all. And this is something which is not a critique. I mean, this is something quite interesting, including to try to reconstruct problematically why it was not their question. And in two very different ways, perhaps. Okay? For Deleuze, I think there is the absolute exception of for real and in absolute real time. This is quite interesting. The one is articulating Warhol as a kind of final reopening of this all problematic indifference and repetition. And at a very, very high level, because effectively, and I think this is my reading, and of course it's a forced reading, but you can from this project something absolutely essential from difference and repetition to anti-aliens. Okay? But then, I mean, yes, you have this text on Fromanger, which is really, yes, but there is this idea, which is crazy. The text opens with the model of the painter became commodity, la marchandise. That's the word. Okay. And then, this is all, you're not going to find this, of course, in Bettenburg, you're not going to find this in what is philosophy, etc. For Guattari, it's of course immensely more ambiguous. There is something in relation to performance, but his real question is the oral question, is some kind of affect. I mean, the problematization of the affect from more or less Bakhtin, and I think that you alluded to Bakhtin. I mean, this is not a question. And when he says stuff against conceptual art, it's really, really quite weak. I mean, we want to agree with him on the critique of, I mean, the most dogmatic version of conceptual art, etc., etc. We do agree with him. But the way he's developing the critique is really quite weak, simply because this is not his question. And at the very end, you just want to say, look, you have the concept on the one hand, and you have the affects, and the percepts, and the body of sensation on the other hand. Okay, this is the most traditionally aesthetic understanding of the question, and we're still in a kind of post-Kantianism, and we're not going to think contemporary art with this. So this would be quite interesting, yeah, to try to determine what is our position with regard to the art today, knowing that anyway, if we address the question this way, we are immediately going beyond Deleuze, and Deleuze and Guattari, beyond Guattari, Guattari. And that's the interesting point, and to assume it as such.
I think I would like to hear from Mark. I mean, you've been making this wonderful art out of their work, and okay, inspiring us with it.
I feel as though the conversation has been looking backwards to what Deleuze and Guattari maybe had said about art. Whereas I think the significant point is that they made some work that has kind of been expanded beyond themselves and inspired a lot of people. And in terms of history, it feels as though, like I'm not a Deleuze scholar, but I do see history in the Thousand Plateaus because they're constantly referring to things from the past or references. So it feels as though there's history in their work, and I think that the significance of their work to art is what it is kind of like radiates outwards. It's not really about what they kind of how they contained it, but kind of what they released into the world, like some kind of crazy hurricane or storm that really just inspired like imaginations. That's kind of how I'm thinking about
and
it.
And like, the afterlife concept.
Yeah, sort of like, yeah, it's like they gave forth a baby, and the baby turned into something that had no idea what it could turn into, you know?
Peter, do you see your practice as doing something similar?
It's a forced silence. One of, I feel a bit alienated to sit here because I have a feeling that it's like being in a Monty Python routine. So the three guys of you have this kind of four Yorkshire men talking about the past and stuff.
But it's funny.
It's not as funny. Sorry, three people. Okay. You're right. Sorry. And I'm just asking, what do I have to comment on? Whereas thank you very much for this question.
Monty Python jokes are always good.
Uh-huh. And I'm boring, it's true. I just had this impulse to go through all this images, so we're thankful for that question too. To kind of, I would be interested in your point of view on how you approach those artworks, because apparently, I would be interested in the way how you read them, what is your tools, what is your technology to look at something like this, because it's here, and it's right here. And you're not speaking abstractly about stuff, because you asked me. I feel very much away from, say, worshipping Deleuze and Guattari. I'm not trying to get close to any kind of Church of Deleuze. My interest in using that abecedaire is comes from a very banal impulse. I was, can I tell that story?
Yeah.
We have 2.5 hours.
Exactly.
Which is, I was invited to do something at the MPAC, which is in Troy, which is the Renzo Leopold Technic Institute. I've never been there, and the curator invited me to do something. And I said to him, okay, listen, if you want me to do something, here's the thing. I have a piano, I have a TV set, I have a dog, and I have me. And on this television set, we can show the abecedaire by the lips. Because I was interested in that. I watched it, and I was totally blown away. So it was this first affect that kind of took me on. And maybe it's the same way when you had the plateau or Silver's Way, when she was totally full of this. And the most horrible thing happened, I said, yes, let's do it. And then I was a bit fucked, basically, because I was not sure if that's a good idea. And then we came up, invited two colleagues, and we came up with an installation in which integrated there was an editing of which basically I was just cheating, because it's just, back then it was 15, now it's 17. So I will never reach 26 minutes. So in my approach, it's very much about looking at the technology, maybe, at the television, and trying to make sense. Can I say that in the Deleuze conference? Trying to make sense. Trying to make sense of what, how does he say it? How does he speak about this in this very moment? So put a bit of the chair on top of the Chantilly. I was totally haunted by the fact, and that was kind of my personal imaginary, that this guy is sitting in his living room speaking as a dead boy. Mm-hmm. Of course, after a while you understand that this is not the living room from which he defenestrated, and this is because he moved before that. But I was absolutely shocked, and this is maybe the embarrassment, the shame of being a man, to look at this man talking, and as it says in the preamble, it says, I'm talking to you as a ghost. And that was Luke, that was my way in, and that kind of carried, exactly, that carried me through the editing process. And other than that, there is a screening tomorrow, maybe 12 after your presentation.
Can I just add a little story?
Yeah.
Well, I saw on television years ago, it was a documentary, a film about Prévert, which is one of my favorite French poems back then. And Prévert, the guy, was sitting just in front of the camera and says like this, "Je suis mort." And it was true, right?
Mm-hmm. Which is always true with this use of technology. That bodies are talking to us.
Well, I wouldn't go that far, because if you say this, so you again have this distortion between real, natural, living bodies, and then the you know. And then, what
that's
is
a media effect. Let's say as a media effect. I don't mean they're really dead and they're really dead alive. It's just a fact of having.
But I just wanted to, as input to prove, because it's very touching, right? To have this actualization, this potential possibility of being in this ghostly way, which is a mode of existence as well.
I wonder if you see any sort of relation to this, how Ian was talking about boredom there, because it's quite interesting how, you know, your film is also, I mean, you extend the time. I mean, I haven't seen it yet, but you're kind of, you're, I don't know if you think you're making it boring, but you're sort of expanding, you know, our sort of original experience of the conversation. So is this interesting to you?
The original version is 8.5 hours, I think, and I think Claire Panet took 1 hour out. And I think it's pretty boring, actually, the original. It's a bit like Warhol, 24 hours of it. Because it's not boring. But that was not my question. I was trying to find a way in sometimes it's illustrative, sometimes it's a comment, sometimes it's plain bullshit, and I was trying to find my way into this, and I think I would be interested in speaking about the thinker narrative of the event of an art process of a work. And this, I would really like to go, if we had time or so, to go through, because I'm interested in looking at it, and I would like to get into your head. What did you think, and what do you think you're doing, basically? What you are doing in this. And it's the same, I was missing this in your presentation, if you don't mind me saying so, because we spoke about the art in such a generalized way, I didn't know what we're talking about. So, for example, my question for you is, when was the last time you went to the theater? And then what did you see, and how boring was it? Because I have to say that these are things I can talk about with you and can disagree or agree or whatever, but in a generalized way of talking about the arts, I don't know what I can contribute in such a round of things.
Well, to answer your question, obviously, a production of a theatrical production of the Japanese TV series Monkey. And it was so cheap, I left at half time. I mean, I took my kids and even they were bored out of their brains. And it should have been fun because it involved monkeys, it involved people doing acrobatic stuff. Yeah, it turned out to be completely terrible. So I left at half time. But again, I wanted, before coming to Mark, I want to ask a little question as well. One of the things that's really interesting to me about
the notion of it should have been fun because of the monkeys. Where does this come from? What is this expectation? Because I just remember the Stiller says, we don't push an artist, so we have no right to push the artist into something else. So how come you think that the moment the monkeys are involved, it should be funny?
Because the character of Monkey is funny.
Okay.
In the Japanese series, he is funny, and his whole point of the character is that he meant to be a trickster, not a character who does funny things. He just didn't perform very well. He's just terrible. But no, the question I want to ask is, one of the things that Deleuze and Guattari talk about around history is to question Freud's definition of history, which is the idea that you can take a patient history and from somebody's description of their history, develop predictive ideas about how they might behave into the future or how you might alter their behavior into the future. And I think one of the key things that they're saying about schizophrenia is that schizophrenics history cannot be used in a predictive way, but also it can't be used in a straightforward hermeneutic way. You can't simply interpret it, you can't find symbols within it, you can't put together a picture. And it has always struck me, and this is getting to your work, Mark, that it has always struck me that what's really difficult to do with Deleuze Guattari is to use it to interpret anything. Because the very thing that they're challenging, of course, is the idea of interpretation based on a hermeneutic model where you could find a set of patterns that you can repeat, but by the same token, they're also not saying that you can't get anything out of history. So that creates a whole new question, which I think your work is so amazingly responding to.
Oh, we have a question.
Yeah, just a spontaneous question, because I'm an actress, and I want to ask you, have you ever met a monkey in reality? I've been quite a lot in India, and meeting monkeys is quite a dangerous thing. And I think art is compelled to deconstruct the clichés. So the cliché that monkey is a funny thing is a very weak, I think, for the perspective of an actress, perspective to a monkey.
Yeah, but the character monkey is a creature.
It's a character monkey, it's not a monkey.
It comes out of Chinese mythology. And so it's a character who has eternal life, but has a monkey face, but he's not a monkey, he's a god. And is a trickster. So it's not an encounter with an actual monkey, it's an encounter with a god in the form of a human/monkey hybrid.
But what does it actually mean here? Can I go back to the spiderism? What does it actually mean here for you? So you are capable to discern, let's say, something that is something else than something else. So you make an operation, apparently based on, let's say, your worldview and the way how you look at things. And then you make a judgment on this. Fair enough, we all do this. How does that coincide with your understanding that is that a binary view of things? So there's a character and there's a being, or
please take your positions yourself.
I'm trying to understand.
You know, there's a joke about this I'm going to tell
Don't remember.
What's the name of the guy who said "Je suis contre les femmes"?
Je suis contre.
Sacha Guitry. So there's this, French bourgeois actor. Went out with a record, and he's talking about all the last sentences. And he's taking the example of a guy who comes and sees his best friend, who's about to die, and says to him, "Oh, you're very lucky because you are going to meet my wife. And please tell her so and so and so." So the guy answers, "Tu pourrais faire tes commissions toi-même."
You could do your...
Touché.
Huh?
I didn't mean it that way. You could do it yourself.
Yeah.
No, but...
This monkey characterization is complicated, right?
Sure.
But then you were asked, what is the last theater play? And so you answer this.
But I think they also think you're sort of using an ironic when you were saying you're born and you left out. I mean, you left.
I think I would say at this point, can we forget the monkey and let Mark talk about the drawings?
Exactly, because the monkey time may be over.
Yeah. Let's move on. Just say go. Let Mark talk.
But you haven't seen the show because you walked out.
I saw the first part.
But you didn't see the show.
Let it go.
Okay. Well, I guess what was interesting about what you said about how that the Uzungatari might want you to resist to make, like needing or construct structures to allow you to interpret the world. Well, I could say that, and then about Freud's approach to history through, like, you know, how to interpret a patient's history by what the patient is telling him. So I would just say that in terms of like the drawings in the middle, that's from the Second Plateau, which is all about Freud and Wolfman and the green ones, yeah, the ones in the center. And I would say that actually, like once I was finished that, I actually had I got a very clear sort of sense that, yeah, they were trying to debunk Freud's kind of, idea that you could kind of like narrow someone's personality down to a couple of events in their lives, and that they were actually trying to illustrate or describe how that's a really kind of dangerous thing, kind of, you know, destructive to the patient. And ultimately, they're just saying you got to open your mind up to all the possibilities and all the people that have been involved in your lives. So they're kind of providing a structure for you to understand someone, but it's a really open structure. It's about just like, okay, so in order to understand someone, you just have to really approach their entire kind of milieu, like, you know, their parents, their factories, the parts of the town they live in, like all the people that kind of, that sort of cloud of influence. And it's tricky because it's not a single point. It's not like it's not reduction. So you have to become comfortable with the idea that you really have to just kind of open your mind to many possibilities occurring simultaneously, which is actually really counter to how, you know, kind of seems Western thought has gone since like Plato started or whatever. They started to kind of make these axioms and trying to reduce things to one point, like Descartes' 0-0, the grid or whatever. Like, so. That was my sense. That's what I got out of it. That's what I learned in terms of like how to interpret a larger system, in this case, personality.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the wolf chapter for me has always struck me as paradoxical because on the one hand, they're saying the wolf cannot represent day in the sort of Freudian fashion. And of course, I have no difficulty with that idea. But then they start to talk about the idea of the pack and the swarming. And I do not... It's not clear to me that that is not also representational. They're not somehow saying that the pack functions in the place of the wolf, and it's still kind of representational. So it's not clear to me where that trajectory kind of goes. And then they go on to talk about, well, then you're kind of just outside of the pack, and so on. So it seems to me that it's a sort of, I'm tempted to say it's an incomplete chapter. I feel like it's the middle bit that's missing somewhere. Maybe it was lost on the way to the publishers. Jameson always says he thought that the Kafka book should have actually been a chapter within 1,000 plateaus. It should have had 13 chapters. They should have rewritten it and put it in there.
Which was somehow the way it was working at the beginning. I mean,
yeah, yeah.
This is not a script at all. Yeah? I mean, it's a Kafka book, more exactly. It's a material of Kafka,
was part of the enormous material, yeah, that they generated and produced for Stefan Plateau's project. Yeah. And then, but I think that it's quite interesting too. I mean, you may be right, but it's quite interesting too to think why they wanted to use it as kind of component of passage between the Antiochus and the Thousand Plateaus, yeah, because this is where you have the notion of the assemblage. I don't like the translation, agencement. I know that agency is completely difficult in English.
Agencement.
Anyway, but this is something quite interesting because including at the very end, yeah, of the catalog, you have this idea, tendential affirmation, but it's right, I think. You have the idea that the diagrammatic has to substitute the aesthetic, yeah? which is something absolutely fundamental if you effectively think that this is one of the ligne de force, I mean, force and forced line, yeah, which is developed through a thousand plateaus. And it's quite interesting, too, thinking that in one of the interviews that Deleuze and Guattari gave on the Thousand Plateaus, it's quite funny because Deleuze says, in his hand, Guattari is close to him, the next work for us would be to develop what Felix calls the diagrammatic, yeah, which he refers back to the very machinic logic at work in the Thousand Plateaus. Of course, as we know, this book has never been written, because of course it's not really philosophy. Yeah.
Can I only just ask, would you say it's never been written, or it's not being published as that book? Because I guess my sense is that if you then, you know, read, I mean, the other way of looking at this question would be to say, how could you then take Guattari's books like Machine and Conscious and so forth, and then actually integrate them back into A Thousand Plateaus and sort of stretch it out? I mean, you know, Jameson gave this wonderful talk on Proust where he said, Proust wrote three volumes of the, you know, the research, and then the war came and he didn't stop writing, but he'd written volumes 1, 2, and 3, so he's like, what is he going to do with this, you know, extra 4 volume? So what you get is volume 1, volume 2, and then he writes 4 volumes, and then he'd already written the conclusion. And it seems to me that, you know, somewhere along the line, A Thousand Plateaus is kind of like that, that Guattari kept writing all the time that Deleuze was putting together the final volume. But it would be a very nice project to actually try to take some of the essays from Machine Unconscious and reintegrate them kind of, you know, in a sort of cut-up way back into A Thousand Plateaus. Because I think, I totally agree with you, but I think actually Guattari answers that question, or somehow he wrote that book, but they didn't write it together. Or didn't publish it together.
I do want to pick up also on, let me respond to that, on the question of the diagrammatic and the aesthetic and the sort of collision or incompatibility or whatever it is. It's not clear to me that it's so easy to make. And then I also think that, you know, if we come back to these drawings and actually sort of try and work out what their function is, aesthetically, you know, it's also clear that there are aesthetic traits that have been taken from a certain sort of history of the diagrammatic that's analogical here. I mean, you haven't, you know, you've gone back to drawing by hand and you're not using the digital, etc., etc. But when we look at this collection of images, we can't actually reconstitute the text that they're interpreting. Now, that's the interesting thing for me when I actually look at them, is that I don't know, you know, I can't read, I can't return to the origin of the textual source that you're using. And I think this is the real question, isn't it? The critical point of the diagrammatic as a sort of mapping that includes these heterogeneous traits with sense, they're sort of in the construction of the sensible, but it's not simply a question of going beyond, like having done with the aesthetic as such, but having done with a particular regime of the aesthetic, which is what your work is about, isn't it? And the redundancy of a particular regime, as Rancière, for instance, has understood that regime. Maybe Eric wants to pick up on that.
No, I mean, I think that if we enter for real into what is at stake with this kind of work and with this kind of problematization, I think that I'm definitely right with your
strong and provocative intervention, which is the real question is, if, for example, with regard to the diagrammatic, it's not a question of meaning, it's not a question of simply deploying, let's say, abstractly, the logical sense of a new regime of art after the aesthetic called, for example, the diagrammatic. It means that you have really, really to work with the artworks. That's the point, which means with the bodies of work. For example, in Défaire l'image, this is effectively what I did, more than producing a kind of theory of the diagrammatic regime of art. It means I needed to elaborate the proper idea as a kind of, not general idea, but kind of general proposition, to go as precisely and with real difficulties into, for example, Ernesto Neto or Elio Tisica, Buren or Gordon Matta-Clark or Gordon Bruce or a few others, or Smithson or whatever. To see how it works, how it can be very precisely and each time in an absolute singularity it is put to work. And you have to do this, of course, and this is quite interesting too. You have to do this, analyzing for real the works, and not only what has been written about the works, but too, analyzing what the artists have elaborated, let's say, discursively, and to reconstruct this kind of body of work. Otherwise, effectively, it's kind of, Rancière made this aesthetic regime, now we do understand how it's working, There is a guy who is now telling us the aesthetic regime is over, and there is a new one after, and with this one I can think contemporary art, and of course it's not a problem for Rancière. This is just bullshit. If this is a project, there is no interest at all. This is just history of ideas. It's not even philosophy. Because at least Rancière, with the so-called aesthetic regime, produced some kind of strong philosophical and political operation. You can fully disagree, but this is absolutely clear. Otherwise, what would we do? You would simply apply some hyper-difficult, hyper-complex, perhaps the most difficult one in Deleuze and Guattari, which is diagrams, diagrammatic, to build something that we want to hallucinate as a kind of pseudo-historical or theoretical necessity. So the real question is to put this to work with very precise body of words and trying to understand what this body of words meant, for example, in the 60s, in a time where the de-definition of art means immediately a de-definition of politics. That's the real question. This is really what is at work. And this is true, of course, including for Buren. If you take the first Buren, Buren's text of the last 60s, early 70s, it's absolutely amazing what he's doing explicitly in between Althusser and difference and repetition. And this is not a question of ideology or something, a kind of discourse that he produced to justify his work. This is thought, if we say, philosophy has not the monopoly of thought. This is thought, which is really in full experimentation of itself, in a total confrontation with the necessities and the emergencies and the breaks of the present. What was going on around 68, immediately before, during, immediately after? And this is something quite serious, because thinking once more historically, what happened for real, immediately after 68, you have had the counter-revolution, and this is what happened. And neoliberalism is nothing else than the most rigorous answer to the 68 break. And I'm not talking about some barricades as a Quartier Latin, but of course as a world, not even event, but process.
Can I just go
really quickly. I like, I don't think that I said that, but you said it so nicely, so thanks for this.
Good.
I like this difference for me between thinking with and thinking about. And that is an interesting thought you just came up with, or you came up with, about the opposite there as an art piece, because the thing itself, the 7.5 hours, is an art piece. You have a score, you have a topic, you prepare the topic, and then you improvise on that. But in order to improvise, you need this ace up your sleeve. You can take it out and then you improvise. And this is maybe why, because Deleuze, as far as I know, didn't take seriously this work he did. For him, it was the books that are serious, and his eyes, and it was just a side thing, you know? And then I think it's interesting because it is an art piece they produced together, and there was some, I don't know if you're familiar with this exactly, it was an encounter, it was a dialogue like that, even though they didn't call it a dialogue. And then they used the material because they didn't have money, and they put it out there on television. So it's amazing to me because why didn't, I don't know this, but that you do not take the piece you do, you think differently in this setup and this condition, this is positive, having a camera pointed at you, as we do right now. And you don't take that seriously as a serious work of philosophy, you know? This is what always struck me, that someone says, whatever we did this, posthume, good enough, but actually this is not part of my work. And I find this interesting. So maybe Deleuze was not so interested in it because maybe it wasn't good enough what he thought or what he said. But maybe the artwork that are you being used, but in this case it's different, Saint Ancien. Sometimes I have the impression that these art pieces, and here as well in this conference, are being used as an illustration. They're not, some of them are not being used as a way of thinking, as a way of producing, they're used as an example. And this is, for me, the least interesting. It's, whatever you call it, the worst, for me it's not so interesting. Which means, why is it not interesting? Because then you deprive of the artwork a specific mode of thinking itself, and you deprive it of its sheer mode of existence. You kind of exploit it in one or the other way to say, my thought is justified, there's legitimation out there, which you don't need, basically. I don't know if you need the art to do this. You can think along.
It's
okay, just
it comes back. I mean, I guess the question is, you know, the conference thematic here is fitting up this concept of artistic research, even though it's some sort of not over-determined in the beginning, into the shape of a conference, so it automatically takes on this problem, which I think maybe people in the audience might want to interject at this point, because it's really coming back to the whole question of really the apparent topic, the normal topic.
Can I just go in between, because now we're touching the politics of it. Artistic research, and I'm somehow also working or feel familiar with this term, because I'm working somehow with institutions, I cannot tell you up to today what it is. I can tell you what it's meant to be, and I can tell you what the marketing strategies are for that. I'm not really sure if those people working in these institutions are interested in that. What I come across with when it comes to artistic research is a lot of times, and that is the worst, is application of names for concepts. Which means you apply, and I have gone through this reading all those, the name Deleuze Guattari just goes, I couldn't hear it anymore. It has become, now it's Ancien, it's a new thing, and now we're by Doughty. No, I'm just saying that. Depends on the communities very
much. Of course.
Yeah? New materialism is coming back. So there's an application of a thought that apparently has a certain kind of validity, and the currency of thought enters the writing of applications. Mm-hmm. Fair enough. At least if you can exploit this and it makes kind of, can settle a career on this, good enough. My question in terms of artistic research is, how do we deal with this? How much space do we give to let artistic research sink in? Because it's a question of time you have to give. And what is the slot of thinking? Is it 1/2 hour? Is it 2 hours, 2.5 hours right now?
Well, I just had a thought. There's a recent controversy in Canada, the difference between like a basic research in science and applied research. And so the idea of, the government of Canada was sort of really focusing on applied research, so this research had to have an end, like a finished product that was commercialized, that you could sell. But then the actual real science is done in this realm of basic research, where you don't know what you're going to do, like you don't know what you're going to end up with. So in a sense, like the research creation for me is kind of how I'm interpreting it. I don't I wouldn't call what I'm doing research creation. This is kind of like mental note taking so that I could understand the book. That's essentially what these are. But in terms of research creation, to me, it's like, it's kind of a new word for something that's always existed. Artists have always experimented and have been like, but maybe it's just about a more methodical approach or something.
It's about money. I mean, the key point you're making is that research is just a code word for applying the money. In my university, you don't give a fuck what you do as long as you get money. And with the golden rule is, can you get money? And so, in the Australian context, in the UK context, artists used to apply to arts councils, but arts councils have less money, and artists are now working in universities, so they're expected to follow the new axiom of universities. And therefore, they're meant to. So, my university has gone through, you know, paroxysms in order to try to come up with a set of axioms that says this amount of art is equivalent to this amount of chemistry, which is equivalent to this amount of doing medicine or whatever. Because if you cannot make those equivalences, then the artist can't get promoted, they can't get grants, they can't get whatever. So you can say, well, do we just refuse that system and say it's ridiculous, we don't want any part of it? And the cool thing is the system will be like, fine, that's good. We don't have to give you any money. You can refuse it all you want, you just won't get any money. And so that's the challenge, right? How do you enter into a system that is ridiculous from the start, that doesn't make any kind of sense according to the paradigms that you have, and nonetheless succeed? Well, that's where you have these things, people come up with artistic research. And so, you know, in my way of thinking, you should actually understand this as a massively creative, interesting political response to use policy against itself and say, artistic research, don't buy into it. See it as a structure of convenience, how to get money out of a system that would cheerfully not give you any.
Trojan horse.
Absolutely. And, you know, the smart artists do that, they get money and they make their work.
If I can jump in, it's exactly the same stuff in university right now. So the operation is what I call put the bucket under the cow.
But I don't want to have an institutional critique here. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the people actually, not who are running this as an institution. I'm not talking about me.
Yeah.
And that's the politics. I have a responsibility to kind of deal with this, and I want to deal with this, and this is the work we have to do. And of course, I would be very eager to exchange the word artistically, so just by working. But then again, we buy another trouble. What I'm trying to say is, because my interest is, how do we create conditions as such here where we can think together? And that will be interesting for me. And I'm not saying that we're not doing it. I'm saying that this is much, let's say, the conditions to create how do we work together is, the, and I think someone else said that, it's not about the politics, it's not about politics, it's the conditions we create to work. I don't know if you're still here. I don't know. Man from America. And we in this, are we aware of this? And this is not a plea, you know, as a judgment call. I'm just saying that the conditions we have can also be challenged in this. And I've missed this a lot of times in artistic research, because exactly for a way of thinking that this is taken for granted. You know? Sorry.
Yeah, there's a question.
Yeah, well, on two things. One is the thing about research creation. That first came out as a way to out of Montreal and Concordia University in order to find a way for artists to be able to access government funding, so they're given some kind of serious space in order to go out and get some money. That was subsequently picked up by the Sense Lab. I don't know if you know of them. The you know, Aaron Manning and Brian
and
a whole bunch of other researchers who worked together on this concept. And the Sense Lab puts out this journal, this online journal called Inflections. It's inflections.org, and the first issue of their of the journal was dealt specifically with the concept of research creation. So if you're thinking about research creation, you can go there, and it's quite explicitly theorized and put.
But I would have to read a text. See, that's what I mean. If it's about artistic research, let's start reading a text.
But look, I think that sometimes, you know, that that thought requires thinking. You know, thought requires work. It's not something that just comes out of the blue and, oh my God, I'm inspired. You know, it's an intuition. And I think that sort of the whole question of intuition needs to be thought out, thought out afresh. So I think that when we say, no, I don't want to read about it, I think that it's sort of a way of just saying, okay, well, that's really not interesting because it requires work. And I think that this kind of research requires work.
I didn't say that part. I didn't say that.
Okay, no, the other, okay, so I don't want to get into that. That aren't global.
I have something to just add, just to respond to that briefly, but you know, artists have always had patronage. So the examples that Anne is giving of Van Eyck and so forth, they're patronage. They have the patronage of the church, they have the patronage of the rich burghers and so forth. You know, art doesn't exist in a vacuum, it never has. And so artistic research now, in some ways, is equivalent to painting for the church 500 years ago. You know, if you were an artist 500 years ago and you didn't want to paint religious images, then you didn't get any patronage. And so therefore you didn't get to paint on the big churches that are now we're looking at 500 years later.
Maybe I disagree with that. I think, you know, the question of artistic research or critical sense of artistic research is not answering to any kind of determinism, any conditioning. And just like Van Eyck would have a sort of aspect, they would have an aspect of their preparatory process that definitely goes beyond the particular specific conditions. So I think that's the question here, isn't it, that you're just asking.
One other thing about that is that I think artistic research is also happening, you know, in academic settings. A lot of artists are going through the academic screens in order to be able to, you know, to develop their ideas. The other thing that I wanted to ask you actually, and is during your talk you're saying that you were talking about the end of political art, that there was no more political art. I think that there's all art is political. I think there's a lot of art that's being done, like basically street art, you could say, that's completely political. I think there's also another kind of art, for example, in the effectual politics, for example, which generate really strong affects and percepts. And I think in some ways that there's a very political or artistic side, or performative artistic side to politics, which makes politics artistic and therefore art being politics. So for me, I found it difficult for you to hear that you were saying that about arts or political arts being dead.
Yeah, look, I mean, it's obviously a provocative thing to say, but I guess it comes down to how do you define political art and when is art being political? Is art being political if I click like on Facebook and do nothing else? I don't think so. Is art being political if I'm walking down the street and think, oh, that's a cool image? No, that's not political. When does it break out of being cool? When does it break out of being a nice ornament? When does it, change how I live? And so for me, I'm defining political art as art that changes how I live and how it changes other people's lives. And so then it's like setting a paradigm for conversation. So it's not necessarily saying it doesn't exist, but it's saying let's not be too quick about saying, well, this is political, that's political, that's political. Because, for the most part, what we are content to say is political is absolutely captured by regimes of capitalism. They're quite happy for you to be as, kind of dissenting as you want. They'll even charge you money to go and look at it. But it changes nothing. I mean, I remember that fabulous video that Rage Against the Machine made, where they made it on the steps of the New York Stock Exchange, which already is now a kind of completely outdated idea because no stock exchange happens at that building anymore. But nonetheless, you see at the end of the image all the police come and try to take the band away. But then there's this very nice slogan at the bottom of the thing which says, no money was harmed. Political art has that problem. We just kind of watch it and think it's cool, but no money was harmed, the stock market didn't blink an eye, the same idiots get elected as presidents. Politics has to change something for it to be political. It has to bring people together to do something different. Not just to say it's cool or really provoked me or I felt something. It's got to do more than that.
Well, like for example, in in occupation, during the occupation movement, there were a lot of initiatives, performance initiatives, which can be constituted as artistic. And I think that's sort of the coming together in a performative way and producing something was very much of an artistic thing. So I feel that aspect was very political and very artistic. And I think what it does is that it changes what the artistic is, in the sense that you can have artistic gestures which are not necessarily artworks, but constitute art in the making as a doing.
Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, Andrew Ross with Occupy when they discovered that they could actually buy student debt at less than 10% of the cost of the actual debt and actually release students from the bondage of their debt, or they could buy mortgages for less than 10% of the cost of the total loan and release people from them. To me, that was a fantastic creative act
are genuinely political. Like, they found a way to make a difference. They found a way to expose a whole new way of thinking about the markets and so forth. So yeah, absolutely, I agree with it. All I'm trying to say is, let's not be too content with the idea that we think we know what political art is. Let's challenge ourselves to, you know, to raise the bar in terms of what counts as political art.
And yet you are describing the definition of quite a sort of...
Well, it's my definition, you have to agree with it.
No, but it's quite an established one, which is, you know, a collective change. And I think, you know, one of the things that came out of your talk actually was something other than that, and which is transformation of subjectivity. So the problem is this sort of overloading and the establishment of these terms, because machinism and constructivism, these terms, in their reworking by all of you, are things that are actually working at a level that doesn't need the visible sort of, you know, the visible effects of change and sort of consensus of movement. And I think that that's interesting, actually, which is, you know, you change the site of the political, don't you? Mm.
Yeah, I think that's more.
I just want to come back to the question of why artistic research maybe pops up in our times. And if I leave at the level of the economic level, and maybe a very reduced level of getting a grant. Maybe if I look back to philosophy, and I'm not a philosopher, but as far as I know, in our ancient times, European philosophy comes out of the ancient Greeks. Socrates or Plato wrote as an artist, a kind of artist, or take Montaigne or take Nietzsche. They were artist philosophers. And maybe we are in a time where we seriously should take the qualities of philosophy and the arts to come together in a kind of research where they could be fertile for both of them, for the academics and also for the arts.
I totally agree.
Because thinking in the arts is as important as being affectionate as in the academics. And if you lose these possibilities, I think both disciplines lose a lot.
I totally agree, but I mean, look at, you know, Deleuze talks about Bartleby as a story.
Yes, I know.
But what's really great about Bartleby is not that Bartleby says, I prefer not to, but that Bartleby starved to death. Mm. So he starved to death because he preferred not to. So is that what we expect of others? To just turn their back on the world and say, I prefer not to participate, therefore I'm going to starve to death? Well, no, that's precisely what I'm saying, but I don't expect that of artists. I accept and understand that artists have to make their way in the world, they have to send their kids to school, they have to buy their bread and so forth. So therefore, art is always going to be some kind of a compromise, philosophy is always going to be some kind of a compromise, but that doesn't mean it's the end of the world. I mean, I think that, you know, in a sense, what I take from Deleuze and Guattari, what they're saying is that politics means the transformation or the challenging or the exposing of norms. It doesn't mean the abrogation, stepping away from all those things, but how do you make your way? You think about Guattari's work with the schizophrenics, he's constantly saying, how do you come up with a set of assemblages that enable people who are schizophrenic to live their lives, to be productive, to go into society and make their way? Well, to make your way means to make compromises, to figure out how to change your environment around you. So I think, you know, that's what I'm getting at, that any kind of gesture that the artists have to make now in terms of the university structure means that they have to make their way with the conditions that they have.
Can I just pick up on, I think the question also was a question of disciplines and you know, these terribly over-fashionable words of practice discipline, interdiscipline and all the rest of it. But one of the issues that's coming up here, and we, you know, Eric kept bringing up, is the question of art history, or history of art, or something, you know, that we putatively call that in retrospect. And I think one of the questions is how also the way in which we are reopening up the history of historical material is actually operating as a critical reevaluation of the disciplinary territorialization that is art history. So, and, you know, this is why I keep asking this question about the social history of art. You know, someone like T.J. Clark talking about Corbe, you know, as a social artist, not because he's reflecting his condition, you know, not, it's not about reflection, but about something which is much more micro-political in a way, you know, and actually talking about a certain sense of the unconscious here, that you have an artist's construction.
But this is something that has been methodologically worked, and I think that is an issue that Eric brought up in terms of how do you determine the body, this body of artistic practices that you want to talk about, that you have to talk about diagrammatically, how are you determining that? Artistry determines it through its method and through its canon,
That's precisely the point you were talking about Colbert. So the modality of Colbert is related with the fact that he was a serial painter. So, not invented, but was one of them. The one who was obliged to paint in series, and the other amazing stuff about his painting is that often he would go back to an ancient painting and repaint it. For instance, there's this beautiful painting where you see him with his portraits with, he's always with closed eyes and like sleeping, so you have this close up like this. And so you have to go through case studies, as Eric did in his last book. And the case study is not art history, this is precisely the point. It is a way to transform the type of art history we need, we're going to do. So, therefore, I couldn't answer in general about your question about sociology. Because at one point, I need it, and it's part of the definition of art machine, obviously. But then, it's not sociological. Only because you have to come up with a certain type of link between what is not an economical level, because we are beyond this idea that economy would be the infrastructural way, and anyway, the economy today is not anymore an economy of merchandise, it is a digital economy as well. So you have to put at a certain level a kind of economy, icon.
No, I completely understand and agree with you. I think my question is one of the definition of the body, the diagrammatic body, because this is not a question, you can't sort of have,
but then
we're not going to talk about arbitrary case studies, because we don't have our own sort of linear history or something. So how do you produce a discrimination about what you intend?
I think there's no single understanding of what artistic research is, and in the first 20 years we're lots of worrying about does art have to become scientific. But I think what this conference is showing is that in the last 5 years Deleuze has been recognised as being really important as something that artists can draw upon. But it has created several interesting questions. Several artists in this conference said they just take from Deleuze what we want, they're not too concerned about getting Deleuze right. And I found that quite interesting, what happens when artists steal and appropriate. And others, if you acknowledge, tend to try to pepper their accompanying thesis with enough Deleuzian terms to make it look Deleuzian full stop. Then there's others that say that Deleuze has nothing to do with epistemology. And isn't this quite worrying that you're drawing on a philosopher that wants nothing to do with epistemology?
Wants to kill epistemology.
Yes.
That's the point.
There's a fourth camp that says, no, if you're working with Deleuze as an artist, you must be prepared to defend it to non-Deleuzians. So there's a whole lovely nest of questions around artists drawing on Deleuze.
That's great.
Eric?
I feel... I feel totally comfortable with this, which means, okay, yeah, you can say this with regard to, the market, elected, let's put it that way, including the institutional market, which is another kind of market, which is the same market or another branch of the market, etc., okay, elected, Deleuze and Deleuze Guattari this last 5-10 years now, perhaps starting tonight, but anyway, as the man of the year or the man of the year, that's fine. What is interesting, eventually,
artist, you know, steal, Cézanne, appropriate, détournement, etc., etc., which is absolutely right, because anyway, it's always a question of capture and to put into variation. Yeah? The first question is eventually, yeah, because anyway, we are in front of such an absolute heterogeneous multiplicity of artists doing stuff or pretending doing stuff with Deleuze and Deleuze and Guattari. It's what not only what do they do, but why do they feel that they need to appropriate this kind of material, okay? Which is a serious question, because anyway, we are coming back to the question of the appropriation, to the détournement, to the consistency, to the etc., etc. Where I'm a bit pessimist is that I think that new real hot spots now. It's not so much the Guattari, it's already speculative realism, etc., etc., which for me is the most reactionary possible stuff, etc. I mean, what are we able to extract from this? What do they try specifically to do with it? What are they using and how are they using it? And once more, we have to go through some kind of case studies. Yeah, what has been produced? Yeah, I don't know. Netto, 15 years ago, okay, started as a kind of concept, perhaps as a kind of operative tool for himself or diagrammatic trait, whatever you want, to use, which means to think, yeah, the question of the body without organs. Yeah, in a place which is the place where you can't do it. You're supposed not to be able to do it because it's all the contrary, which is Le Panthéon in Paris. Okay, so let's see what he did. Is it consistent? Is it interesting? Is it radical? Is it new? Is it creative? What is at stake? How does it work? Okay. But you see too that a large part of the question is the kind of reconstruction of something which has to be operative and not only a narrative. Yeah? But is it specific with Deleuze and Guattari, or is it specific of any kind of use done by artists of a certain kind of philosophical material? I don't know. Perhaps there are some specific stuff. And quite obviously, I think they have something to do in between art and politics. And what is interesting is that if you said art and politics, this is the most terrible cliché that you can announce, yeah? It's more interesting if you see what, including a kind of totally unconscious, blind, self-hallucinated way, they are trying properly to produce with a body of work.
We have a few questions also, Peter.
Just go, the moment you are defining the quality of an artwork, you're using a row of adjectives, which is new, innovative, radical. I'm just interested in this. So. I'm also like to talk about that once, maybe later, but it's impressive to me that here apparently there's not a problem to kind of summon those qualities as if that's the work art has to do. That's the reason for art, whatever art is in the world. But that's, no, just want to say that.
Okay, do you have a question?
Yes, it's not starving to death. Bartleby is starving to birth. And it is death for Bartleby is to be understood in the sense of an end, but not the end as a finishing, but the end as an aim, as a task. He has a task. And it's in one sentence in Malick's text, which not even Giorgio Agamben has captured, he writes, "I prefer not to dine today." And that's what we read. It's the visual. We read the text. When we read the book, we read, "I prefer not to dine today." But what we hear inside is, "I prefer not to die today." So he prefers neither to die nor to dine. And that's maybe a task that an artist can have. And an artist's research.
So we don't eat, but we still don't die.
With regard to the conditioner again, which is the neoliberal condition, how can we starve ourselves to birth?
Anorexic optimism.
Exactly.
How?
Anorexic optimism.
Yes. Anorexic
optimism. But my point is that neoliberalism doesn't care. I mean, you can starve yourself to birth, starve yourself to life, starve yourself to death, starve yourself any way you want, but, you know, nothing happens. Money won't be harmed, therefore they don't care. So that was my point, that you, how do you make a gesture in the realm of a system that does not care for the beautiful gods?
What is boredom? Or what is indifference with regard to the less indifference? I think that's an interesting question.
Yeah, it becomes a question of positioning and finding a place, you know, to locate that aspect of boredom within the process of becoming. And I thought that that's sort of that's something that was, you know, that you didn't discuss in your thing, which I thought would have been an interesting way of seeing boredom, you know, as part of the, you know, metaphysics of becoming.
Yeah, absolutely, I agree. I mean, and it sort of goes to Eric's point as well, the sort of demand that things be interesting. I'm going to pick up on something that Mark said as well, which is that, you know, artistic research as an axiom within my university must kind of come back to this: either is it pure basic research, I'm allowed to just do whatever I want regardless of what the results might be, or is it applied research whereby I have to tell you what the results might be. Now the problem for artists under that axiom is that they very, very rarely get money under the pure basic, give me a ton of cash and I'll just go do whatever, and it might produce art, it might not, I might just have a nice holiday on a Greek island and it may produce wonderful art thoughts, or it may not. They never get that kind of money. They have to say, give me some money and I'm going to weld together six fish and do this, that and the other, and it's going to be art. And then they have to justify that to get the money. So the point I was trying to make is that artistic research is a conversation, it's a way by which artists engage with a machine that otherwise doesn't care about them, otherwise wouldn't give them money. I don't think we need to kind of get too hung up on the definition of it, other than to see it as a necessary pragmatism. If we could get to the point where artists could say, I want to do pure basic research, give me a ton of cash and I'll just go and think about stuff. And I'm like, I mean, philosophers would be queuing up for that as well. But that doesn't exist under the neoliberal regime, and that's the crucial thing.
It seems to me like it's such a difficult problem.
Sorry, I think we've got a new question here.
I just wanted to go back to the question of why artists use Deleuze, because I'm an artist and I've been really interested in Deleuze's philosophy for a long time. And one of the, I suppose, the things that's come up for me is that it's that escape from the representational image of thought. And given the fact that artists all work with words and text within a theoretical context, because we can't help but do that. When we look at, I'm a painter, but look at paintings, as soon as you look at a painting, there's a whole stuff of words that go with it. And so it's about how you work through the givens of that and overcome the clichés inherent in that. So I think Deleuze is really useful for developing a kind of open-mindedness, if you like, to the actual making of stuff and what's actually going to, how do you do something that's going to be truly surprising and different. And so I wonder also if that addresses the issue about a politics, because who are we to say what a work of art is politically? Isn't it for the work of art to do that itself, and for us to maybe use words to try and get close to that, or even think that that might be a possibility? So I don't think that the idea of being in a position to say it's art or political or not is, well, certainly not the job, I don't think, of an artist. I think that resistance is political in itself.
May I join this poor problematic? What's really interesting, I find it very perplexing of how a philosopher whose work is so incredibly complex and difficult has become a point of attraction for artists. Mm-hmm. But I'm asking, what is the degree of responsibility, or rather, what is the degree of liberty an artist may take with the work? So, if, for example, if I take the example of Deleuze's relationship to either Bacon or cinema, the degree of liberty is absolute as long as he produces a version of the cinema that has a vitality that is stronger than any other version we have seen before. My question, yes, it is.
Can we get rid of this notion of innovation? Can we just get, why is the artist the only one who has to deal with this, I would even call it ridiculous understanding?
I did not speak of innovation, sorry. I said, what is the degree of liberty they can take with the work?
Never seen before.
No, I said, sorry,
isn't that making a difference?
Okay, it's important to understand what I'm actually saying.
Yeah, but now we're getting into some
other. The degree of liberty of Deleuze is absolute as long as he produces a cinema whose vitality is greater than anything that, you know, Bazin or anybody else has produced before. So is there such a responsibility of some sort of a risk that an artist may fail in turning to be inspired or working with? At this conference, I've heard several artists using the work of Deleuze, absolutely reductive, not understanding any of the, you know, using caesura, becoming, event in a kind of, and I do not really have a judgment on that as long as the work itself does not need to refer back to Deleuze as a source.
Yeah, exactly.
If it can leave it behind and say, here is my work, and forget how I got here.
But I think this question
fails. Do they produce, I take a neutral word, whatever, to be killed, but are they producing interesting artworks, displacing anything?
Interesting is the latest of shit, which has hurt
exactly. No,
I'm just joking. Interesting, let's call it interesting. Of interest, not interesting. But to whom? Does it have to be interesting for you or for me?
That's like reducing it to relativism. Most of all, they're subjectivism. Sorry.
Okay, here we go.
The work has a force or it does not.
Okay.
Yeah. It's not a question of your personal judgment.
Yeah.
So, the moment is out there. It is out there. It is green. It is there. It's there. So, of course, we don't have to talk about it in this way. What I'm trying to kind of refrain from is the notion of that apparently, when we talk in philosophical terms, when we use the art, whatever that is, and I have to say, quote, unquote, is there is a certain expectation to it. It has to fulfill a certain, I don't know, quality. This is what I hear. And I'm just describing it.
Philosopher never talks about art.
Wait, no, you just made a judgment. You said there is pieces of.
You are reducing the philosophical discourse to something that it is not. It's not really speaking of art as such.
That's what I hear. Maybe I'm wrong. And what you just did is you were using the artistic contributions and saying they were not so good.
Did I
hear it wrong? Did I hear it wrong? I heard it wrong.
I think it's also a question. Are they going into art or are you? What is your stuff?
Because I'm trying to raise a different order of question.
No, I mean, what are you doing? Because I don't know.
Oh, what are you doing? I am. I don't like Leibniz. I like Godard, cinema.
You're a writer.
Yes.
So you
have. I am an academic who is writing on a certain subject.
Okay. I want to
elaborate a bit on the force of art. Kind of nice phrase, I think. Then you can avoid these kind of cliches of innovation, etc. So let's call it the force of art, that it affects something. It's kind of interesting idea. What it affects, you don't know. Mm-hmm. But it's kind of effectively doing something. And then the next step, the question you just hinted at, when you talk about art, or when you think about art and you think with art. So assume there are two roles, the artist and the philosopher. An artist thinks about art, he does, because he thinks about other artists, etc., and he thinks about his own art. And at the same time, the artist thinks with his art. That's a kind of deal the artist has with his praxis. So there's a kind of doubleness in the artist. He thinks about art, whether he is a thief or whatever he takes from other art works, or whether he's a kind of integrity and he really has kind of a tribute to another artwork, doesn't matter. He thinks with art and about art. These two roles are fused in one function, so to speak. Now we have the philosopher. What is he doing? He's thinking about art.
Not about.
He's something about. Let's call the philosopher an artist. He's also thinking about art. He's just reflecting on art. But when he collaborates with an artist, that's the point. When he collaborates with, I want to speak some words. When he collaborates with an artist, then he is assumed to think with the art. But what is the value of his thinking with the art? Is he doing art? What is he doing?
Thinking.
Yeah, but what does he contribute something? I have worked with several artists as a philosopher. The main issue is, also the complex issue, it's not just an ontology, a pop ontology on board. It is, the complex situation is that you are denied to contribute to something to the artwork, because you have no signature there. Mm. Well, then you appropriate more or less the artwork. So you distance yourself from the artwork, and at the same time collaborate as a kind of gangster, in a kind of collaboration underneath, have a kind of engagement with the artwork, but doing something else. So, what is this kind of complex combination?
You can answer it yourself, because you did it, you know it. Yes. I would be interested in your answer.
Yeah. I know if I can, because you were talking about artists and philosophy, and I'm reading and I'm listening to people who were very near, very to Deleuze and Carmelo Ben. And I was at the archives of Carmelo Ben in Rome that are closed now. But the first thing I asked for was to see Deleuze's books. When they opened they gave me the chiavi to see this. And I was very emotional when I opened one of the books and one letter from Deleuze to Carmelo Ben. Then I realized that it was not in the inventory, but I was in Brazil and there was no number for this letter. But I caught everything. It was so strong. It's an example of a friendship and of approximation, which was not an institution, because then we have the institution of the money and of the scholars and participating with the artists, etc. We have to see what's happening. A friend of the Pope who presented them, Jean-Paul Manganahoff in Paris, he told me, and we see that Carmelo Ben was not a Deleuzean, but he was at the same time. And you can say that Deleuzean was a Benian also, you see? Because it was something else. It was, but not something institution. It was something that crossed them, and with no, I don't know. It's something. It's different. As now we have institution of intellectuals collaborating with artists. As in Brazil, we have a little bit like that. You have the speeches. You have money for that. You have to see
writing in catalogs.
But I don't see this kind of. I mean, that's a kind of practice, but no, they don't exclude each other.
And I think that this sometimes I feel this in Brazil also. Mm.
that it's a kind of a fashion. It's cool to be Deleuzian, etc., etc., and it's a little bit empty, boring sometimes. And sometimes I take part at some, I say to Banca. It's when you have to.
Fala in português, posso falar?
Banca, banca de mestrado, de doutorado,
jurídico.
And I take part just to say in the artist department to say why so much Deleuze here. So because it's a little so. And I guess, and when I see, for example, this approximation with Benny's works and texts, etc., etc., it's nice this to escape from this, because it's very it's impossible for me to put Benny into a box that I would be comfortable saying, oh, this is this and this is this. There are many things he said that Deleuze hadn't had time or necessity, or it was not the to use or to. And they are very interesting.
So it's
may
so
I add some? May I add
to respond?
May I add?
Just one sentence from Carmelo Bene, which I like. I don't know if I can.
So I think because there's going to only be about a short amount of time, sorry, so I need to make sure everyone gets a chance to talk. Sorry.
May I add a few words? So the crucial point is here not the institution, which you're right, the institutions are there, you have to be clever to have your money, etc.
We are.
But we are. So that's the point, I think. Okay. But the other point is what we refer to is the relation between the kind of position of philosopher and position of the artist. When it is inert and solidified, or is stuck into some kind of no-go area where they are two separate individuals, they cannot become, to use the Deleuzian phrases, they cannot become something. So they have to be involved in becoming an artist and becoming a philosopher, both. Otherwise, you don't have anything.
Okay, we have one question.
Yeah. No, I just wanted to go back actually to two concepts that Anne has brought up in her talk, Yaron, that seem fundamental to me. And one was the concept, maybe a large view of. Mechanisms of production of sensory motricity, and the second one was the question of formalism intended as a mean of transformation. And I'm wondering if the question between art and politics, art and institution, the question of the division between artist, philosopher, can be followed, which can be, or can be shifted in terms of a problematization of the concepts of, well, the division between, or better said, a restructuration of the pre-partition of concepts, affects, and function versus person, can be like kind of from there you can start of rethinking and rearticulating a way of inventing a way that is surely not giving an immediate response to the political question, to the question of the institution and so, but to inventing maybe another trajectory out of it, or simply to pose this problem.
Does anyone have a response to that?
I think, I mean, maybe just...
Well.
Yeah,
there
was a lot.
Can you still play volleyball?
Jump in a few minutes ago, reminding the fact that it's real bright way to answer those questions. The way that Deleuze called his book on Carmelo Bene, superposition. And so it doesn't mean that you have one and another. And the name of his text is Commentary Less and Commentaire de Moins, which would be a perfect answer to your interrogation, because it's not a commentary more, and it raises the question of what is a commentary. So I am pretty much confident that in order to get rid of these questions of philosophy and art, we need to come up with a critique of analogical commentary. So, and I completely, I completely agree with you to say that art has to be new, which is, of course, a sabbatical position that I might be tempted to have as anybody else. Something that has been repeated still until the Kant's writing in the end of the 18th century, so it's completely paradigmatic and absolutely institutional. So there is nothing more cliché than this idea that art should be the new or the... But then it's difficult to get rid of the idea that sense has to be produced. So we have to come up with a conception of production that is not only this old cliché that art has to change in a very colonial way the mentality of old good taste. So this is difficult.
Yeah. So I don't think it has to, but it happens. That's how you
detect. My point is that we are saying this for 200, 300 years, and that the real way to do it would be to claim that art has to change nothing. Yeah. You know? So.
Yeah, you know, I totally understand, but I think it happens to be new by sort of recognition by the exterior that attracts it. Well, there's something new there. As an artist, I don't know if I'm doing something new, but I really want to eventually come to someone or to the books, the situation.
Si ça marche, because yeah. In English works.
And in a sense, I think it's, there's not an issue.
Let's be clear about the question of the new, which means, of course, the hyper-problematization of the very question of the new. Let's not forget that from, let's say, Popart, and then, well, just to come back to the very beginning of the discussion, etc., etc., at least on my part, yeah, the new was so problematic, yeah, that it was coming from the very duplication of the same. Yeah, which was the whole question of the simulacrum, which means too that from the 16th, yeah, since you have, let's say, the real subsumption, yeah, of society into capitalism, and even before this, you don't have any kind of outside. If there is no more any kind of outside, the very question of the critique becomes extraordinarily problematic. And that's why somehow you need 375 ages to sell you, which means to construct and to reconstruct and to reconfigurate, let's say, Warhol as, let's say, a political art, yeah, which is the less obvious possible thing. Yeah, so that's. Let's not be ingenuous thinking that, okay, that's the old modern, modernist motive of the question of the creation of the new, because here too, you have the break of the 60s. This is where you can't go on simply
who's a very, very samurai friend. And this is where it's becoming terribly difficult, yeah, for art. And this is the interesting thing. And this kind of terrible principle of selection.
I have to admit, I go a lot to theater and I see 85% is boring. Okay?
Yes.
Does it mean it's no art? No. What does it mean? It means I don't find my agencement in this. And I don't create an agencement. And I think this is what we have to do. So rather than speaking about if it's boring or not, or interesting or not, or new or not.
Is there, because it's not necessarily you who are creating the agencement.
I am creating it when I go to that theatrical place. Mm-hmm. And that's the responsibility. And I think there lies a lot of politics in this. In that, how do I come up with this relation and this relationality to the work I'm watching and I'm beholding and I'm participating?
But don't you think there's a problem maybe with theater, this kind of exhausted form?
I have to say that, and that just crossed my mind, maybe, and maybe the philosophy also suffers from that, because when you speak about art, mainly philosophers, now I'm also generalized, I like that, a lot of times, let's say, the examples they use are from the fine arts section. So Rancière uses a lot of fine arts, and when Rancière speaks about theatre, I would totally disagree. So it's interesting when in this book, what's the name of this book? I don't remember.
Spectateur,
such an old-fashioned
notion.
Nevertheless, to overcome.
Book.
Nevertheless, the moment you try to use...
Who's ever cited the book as an example of philosophy? Dealing with so-called art.
I like your normativity in this, but I'm just using. I'm just using that. So maybe when you guys speak about the artistic or the artistic practice, maybe we speak about different, let's say, disciplines as well. So you're using cathedral. Was it again Van Eyck? We speak about the visuals. Let's say Facebook. We don't speak actually not so much about the theatrical forms. Let's not even say performance, but really in terms of theatre, as what? As the art form of human
philosophy.
Maybe. And I'm not a fan of this book, I totally agree on this with you. What we call theatre, okay? Let's not overdo it here. I think that is also maybe a question. So, of course, from a theatre-making point of view, we'd say we didn't even exist in a way. Because why we have come through this, the ephemeral stages of the artwork, blah, blah, blah. So there's nothing to analyze because we do not, we resist differently.
It's not a question of analysis, but it's also such a dubious term. Analysis is a relation to an object.
I didn't use analysis now.
You just used it.
We are all exhausted. It could have happened to anyone.
I would like to
be
able to
have always told them. Just telling you
that. Just one footnote to the new. Deleuze talks about an absolutely magnificent Eisenstein film that was produced 50 years after Eisenstein and saying it's worthless. That is the context of what does it mean to produce something new.
Right. But I'm also happy that artists can take away the monopoly and just do whatever they like with this Deleuze and books and the font. Actually, I'm happy about this.
As long as
I hope they destroy it. Use him. Do whatever you like. I mean, like, the understanding of a monopoly is that there's a right way and a wrong way, whatever, as far as... No, then we are right. We're on the same page.
There is a sense of rigor in the work, and it must be there in both... Fears. You cannot just.
You can.
Well, of course, physically, etc. Okay, you can, but there has to be some measure of requirements against which you test your. You know, sometimes Deleuze talks about how life tastes itself, so as to measure itself. Is it worth living?
Yeah, I just think that at this point in time, our conversation is standing in the way of us in the bar. And so maybe the body asserts itself, and let's call this thing to an end and get a drink, because I'm sure conversation will reassert itself in the presence of alcohol.
I do agree. We all agree.